So for our first question for the reconcert, how did your trio form?
Okay, that's a great question. So Misha and I have been playing together for 7 years, and we initially actually started off as a string quartet, and we realized that string quartets are really, really hard. No, but we fell in love with the piano trio repertoire, and so we formed the Neave Trio in 2011, and then in 2012 we were asked to be the trio in residence, the Fish Axelrod Trio in residence at San Diego State University. So we moved from Boston to San Diego, so it's like you couldn't have a more polar opposite experience. And before that, I should say I'm originally from Boston, that was like moving away from home. But Misha is originally from St. Petersburg, Russia. So Misha went from Russia to Boston to California. So it's pretty different. But that's how we formed. We met in school.
How did you come up with the name of your group?
Okay.
You should answer this question.
Okay. So Neave. We found out after the fact. I want to make that clear. We found out after the fact from a radio producer that it in Gaelic means bright or radiant. We sort of fudged the spelling because if we spelled it in Gaelic, it would have like silent M's and P's and H's, and it would be very complicated. But so Neave means bright and radiant, which we found out later. But the reason we named ourselves Neave is because we had very formative musical experiences where we had a dear friend whose name was Bruce, and he was someone that loved classical music. It meant the world to him, and he would come to all of our concerts. But then he found himself unable to. He actually had an accident, and he was unable to leave bed. So we would go to him because it seemed like the only and most natural course of action was, okay, if you can't come to us, we'll go to you. And so we would come to him and play for him. And we always felt that it was this really meaningful exchange that selfishly we almost got more out of than he did, because we would go and play for him and then sort of giving what we could in that way. Afterwards, he would give back. He would tell us stories about his life before he had had this accident that led him to be bedridden. And he would most notably tell us stories about his family and his daughter, who he was very proud of and whose name is Neave. So it was to sort of encapsulate that experience of why we believe so strongly in what we do, and the power of chamber music in particular to connect people on a very intimate level.
That's wonderful. So how were you guys introduced to music and then eventually chamber music?
That's great.
I talked so much.
You want to start with
you?
Okay. I started with piano when I was, I think, 3. And my brother is a pianist as well. Both went to a neighborhood school. And then eventually, I guess the competition of both for pianists, he was doing much better at it. And actually, honestly, I really loved the cello sound. It always fascinated me. And I got to try the cello and I met this wonderful teacher who I spent the next 7 years with. My started cello when I was 10. My parents never played any instruments, but they always loved classical music. Chamber music, actually, I didn't get much experience back in Russia, but when I get here to the United States, it's such a great tradition here. The first semester at school in Boston, I was in, I think, 9 groups at the same time. So I got that concentrated dose of chamber music in the first few months I was here, and I just fell in love with that experience. I played a little bit in Russia, but it was not as serious, so I really loved it. That was the first time introduced to chamber music, I would say, in a real way, about years ago, not that long.
My mom has a piano at home that my grandmother gave her as a wedding gift, but my mom wasn't planning to give me piano lesson at all, because both my brother and sister had such a bad experience with the teachers. Like, one of them hit my brother's hand so much, and the other always fall asleep during the lessons. So my mom's like, oh, maybe no piano for the youngest, you know. So, but she told me, like, always go to the piano and just keep playing. So she said, okay, just try it. And I just, you know, keep playing all the way from 5 until college, but my chamber experience actually started when I was third grade because I was in music school. And maybe it's a talent, I could read music really fast. So my friends, like all the instrumentalists, would say, oh, please play this with me, like last minute, you know. So I started quite early and I made so many friends with the instrumentalists. So, and I also play violin, so it sort of helped. And I've been loving it so much since then, yeah.
So, it's ironic because now I don't stop talking, but when I was 6 and a half, I had a speech impediment. So I couldn't say L's or K's. But my parents were pretty laid back. They were like, eh, you're fine. So eventually I started getting teased a little bit. So my mom, who's a special ed teacher herself, she said, okay, we'll get you checked out. We'll make sure everything's all right. So I went to this teacher, and apparently, I don't remember this, but apparently this teacher was not really what you'd want in a speech therapist. And she was a little, I don't know, she made things a little bit worse. She was like, do you know everyone's making fun of you? And I was like, oh, okay. I didn't, cool. So my mom, being the teacher that she was, she said, oh, I have to get rid of this memory. And at the time, I had been bugging her to take violin lessons. So she said, didn't you want to play violin? Wasn't that something you wanted to do? And so I said, sure. And so we walked down the street in Belmont, Massachusetts, to the Powers Music School. And my mom walked in. We knew nothing about music. We don't have any musicians in our family, really. Except my dad's name is John Williams. I've tried to use that before. Doesn't always work. So we walked into his music school, and my mom said, I don't care who you give, but just I need a violin teacher that has a good attitude. And I started with that teacher, and I studied with her for 7 years. And then for chamber music, I think I came about it a little bit later, but I was really lucky because I grew up going to the New England Conservatory in their craft division. So they have a really great program there. So I was probably like 11, and then I ended up going to the Walnut Hill School in Massachusetts, which also has a really wonderful chamber music program there. So I was really fortunate to just have some really wonderful chamber music experience early on. I hope that answers your question.
Kind of going off on the last question, have you ever participated in any programs similar to CMC?
Honestly, I've never seen anything like this anywhere else. This is truly unique. It's an amazing, amazing program. And Debbie Price, you're a magician. I don't know how you're doing. This is unbelievable to have such commitment from all the faculty and from the students, such enthusiasm, and that it's specific to chamber music, I think is just so unique. So you guys are so lucky to be here. I feel lucky to be here for 2 days, and I don't believe. So no, I've never seen anything like this. It's amazing, and I think Debbie should get an extra round of applause.
Experience, you know, the rehearsing and spending time together is one thing, but the performance, especially some more than others, you really have that somewhere deep in your conscious forever, I would say, you know, that's what's so great about chamber music, is that connection experience through music. So that's, I guess, my sort of a vague answer.
And 4 days ago, we were doing this radio live broadcast in Rochester.
Yeah.
What's this year's name?
Live from Rochester.
Yeah. And so three of us were playing, and because I need a percussion for the kids a lot, so I use our house host, the spatula, okay? And right when we start playing, the spatula, one of the chip, break and almost shoot in his head. So we should just have to pretend nothing happened and keep playing. So sometimes these happen.
You have piano moving and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah, we've had, I think that the best stories are when everything goes wrong. Like, we've had a piano that's been on wheels, and they thought that they locked it, but they hadn't, and so the piano just kept on moving. And at one point, Nietzsche had to, like, nudge it back with his arm. And this was in a production that we were doing that was us and dancers, and so we were like, wait, we're not supposed to be dancing. Like, wait, we're not supposed to be taking over the stage, but the piano was, in fact, trying to take over the stage. So I think the best stories were when everything was wrong, or like when pages like fly everywhere, and like we've had obvious members like catch them, and it's, you know, we are really interactive, so.
Could you speak about the value of musical mentors, or either as individuals or as a quartet?
Invaluable. I mean, so, like, I'm speechless because it's so important to have your teachers are everything. Do what they say. I mean, your teachers and your teachers and your coaches, they give you all the tools. It's like giving you all the colors on your paint palette, you know, that then you get to use. But I mean, without them, without the models of you know, groups and individuals, teachers, coaches that, or just artists that maybe you haven't interacted with, but you love their playing and you're inspired by them whenever you hear them in person or in recording or what have you. It's so important because that's where you, I think that's where you can draw inspiration when you're not quite sure. And then on a very practical level, they're the ones, your teachers, they're the ones that are with you day in and day out. Your coaches, they're the ones that help you with the interpretation. I mean, it's everything. I mean, your mentors are so important.
Mm-hmm. Well, and even outside the musical part of, you know, mentoring, and you guys probably know that, like, as fellows of Gems of Connection, you know, you learn more than just music. You learn all the other side of being part of the musical world, and morals and things like this. It's a huge, it's a second set of hands. Sometimes you spend, I'm from Russia, I went here to the States, my teacher speaking my American family, and still to the day, I basically see them as my parents, so it's really a huge one. Yeah.
These are great questions. Really great questions.
Any words of wisdom for aspiring musicians?
I mean, I guess it's sort of a generic thing, but I think always, you know, be true to yourself and be stay yourself. And come back to the previous question of mentors, you know, don't try to use what they give you to inspire things in yourself, as opposed to just take them on and just, you know, repeat things to people, really take them on your own, and value what you have to say. You know, don't become just another cellist or another violinist, just another quartet. Make it your own thing. You know, be honest with yourself.
Just want to say, we are in 21st century, and there are so many technology and internet resources. And I would really encourage students to use these resources to promote themselves, and don't just live inside this box. Because I mean, classical music is amazing, but you know, now like we have so many creative people, artists, and you know, can try to reach out and collaborate with them and use these amazing internet resources. Yeah.
And I guess I could say, do it because you have to, you know, because there's something inside that, you know, just you have to get up, and it's through your music, through your playing, and because you love it, and that it fills you with joy, and I know maybe that sounds a little cheesy, but I think that's what it's all about, of giving to your audience, you know, it really is a gift that we're able to play this music, and to never forget that, even when, you know, there are down days and up days, but to remember that it's really a privilege to get to play this music. And I think being good to one another, being really good to one another, because I think the music world, sometimes we forget to do that because we get a little worried about where we are and what's going on with us. And I think it really applies to be, you know, if you're good to one another, it'll make the whole world, but also the music world, a better place. better, friendlier, warmer place, which is what music should all be about.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, round of applause for...